Welcome back to the Lowcat. Yeah. So thank you for tuning in back again. Today we're going to look under negligence. We're going to look specifically at defenses and damages. All right. Hope you've been well. But yeah, let's get down to this. So defenses. Three main defenses we're going to look at today. The first one is voluntary assumption of risk. Basically, the claimant has consented to be harmed, which is very rare to actually be able to establish. And this is a complete defense. Means if the defendant is able to establish that the claimant has voluntarily took the assumption of risk, he wins the case. All right. So voluntary assumption of risk, when it doesn't work, it is in Road Traffic Accidents Act. You cannot claim voluntary because nobody crashes into another car voluntary. So that won't be allowed. In that case, you would fail. And that case, our example is Dane versus Hamilton. All right. Sorry. And of course, in Nettleship, the full knowledge and willingness to accept the risk. So that is a bit difficult to even establish. The second one is illegality, which means you get injured while you're doing something illegal. Basically, you have burgled a house and you try to escape from it. You jump through a window, police is trying to catch you and you hurt yourself. You cannot claim that as a defense. All right? A classic case will be Pitts versus Hunt. Thirdly, will be contributory negligence. So contributory negligence speaks for itself. If you've contributed towards the negligence, then the court will take into consideration how much reduction of damages you can receive. Okay? So in contributory negligence, they normally look at the Law Reform Contributory Negligence Act 1945. Okay, I operates to reduce the claimant damages receiving. And of course, they have a special contributory like children, passengers and drivers, and passengers who accept rides from intoxicated people. So these are the main defenses that we should look at when we are looking on what the defendant will want to establish in order to reduce his damages. Okay, so moving on to damages, and damages basically is remedies. The general principle for remedies is that they want to put the claimant back into the position if the tort was not committed. And the one action rule for remedies is that it's only one claim and one set of facts. And of course, the another general principle is that mitigation of loss. Claimant should not profit from it. They should have taken reasonable steps to mitigate their loss. And of course, contributory negligence reduced on findings. So there's two types of claims generally, non-fatal claims and a fatal claim. The non-fatal claim divides into loss and pecuniary losses. So the first one for the non-pecuniary is that the pain and suffering can claim it under due to fear of surgery, past or present pain or physical pain. But they cannot claim if they are unconscious. They have to be conscious of this pain. All right? That's a case of Weiss versus Kai. Factors are the number of operation, disability, scarring, whether it's a dormant hand or non-dormant hand. That will also matter in the claim. And of course, under the non-pecuniary losses are the loss of amenity, meaning the loss of enjoyment of life. So if you used to be a cricket player and due to the accident you can't enjoy your hobby anymore, then that would also affect how much you get and whether if you are single, what marriage prospects have you lost, that will also be taken into account. But this loss of amenity for claim, they do an objective test where they did it in West versus Shepherd, and this can include even when you're unconscious. Of course, the more active the claimant was before the accident, the more claim they can actually establish and get. And has, of course, the claimant sustained such losses is what you need to find out for this. The second one is pecuniary losses. So pecuniary losses are calculation in accordance to the head of losses. So there's like what, 8 head of losses, like medical expenses, loss of earnings pre-trial, loss of earning post-trial, loss of earning, the lost years they call it. For self, they have these Ogden tables where they will use the multiplier method and calculate it with the Ogden table. So for yourself, they do a reduction of 33% if you have no children, but you have children, then it'd be 25%. The loss of earnings for children, cost of care, even carers, loss of earning capacity, which is also known as the Smith and Manchester Corporation Award. Other pecuniary expenses will be the damage to property or household aids, what is required to sustain the client, the claimant when he goes home. Is there any modification needs to be done? Does it cost him more? And of course, when his medical expenses, it also includes the transport he has to take to and fro, going to the hospitals, going for his rehab. So all these, the court will take into consideration. And of course, the next step to calculating how much they will also get is the deduction by tax and national insurance. And insurance payments, family members who give money or charity help that donated to them or even pension, they are never deducted. They will not be inclusive, you see. So that will not be touched if someone has given you out of pocket. State benefits are deductible, but not for non-pecuniary losses. The general method of payment is that the one action rule means one lump sum. So the courts will do the calculation and tell you, and you'll be paid one lump sum. But there's an exception in the Senior Courts Act 1981. In section 32, if you deteriorate further, okay, if you deteriorate further, another sum will be awarded. So this is the exception for one lump sum. All right. So this is the non-fatal claims that you can do. For the fatal claims, is the same principles as the non-fatal claims. All right. And the next thing you need to look is the claims under law reform. Miscellaneous Provisions Act 1934. So you have to state the location of the debt because the estate claims on behalf. And how it works, the personal representative will claim on behalf of the estate. What can be recovered will be the survival period losses between the tort, when the tort occur, till death, the date of death. You can claim both pecuniary and non-pecuniary losses. But what you need to know is under this act, you cannot claim for dependents. So rather for these fatal claims, they would actually want to claim under the Fatal Accidents Act 1976. Okay? So remember, the Law Reform Miscellaneous Provision Act, that you cannot claim for dependents. If you want to claim for dependents, you need to claim under Fatal Accidents Act 1976. Okay, so it allows dependents to sue for death. How it works is basically personal representative will bring the claim on the behalf of the dependent. Who qualifies as a dependent? There is a list where you can check under the Fatal Accidents Act Section 1-3. There's a list of dependents stated there, generally spouse, our former ex-spouse can assist our parent or someone, this child, or you have cohabited together for more than 2 years. It has to be more than 2 years. And of course, they are financially dependent on the deceased. Okay, once all these are satisfied, then that's brilliant. So the three claims that I raised are loss of dependency. So you need to use the multiplier method with the Ogden table. And then you have the bereavement allowance, which is a fixed sum. So you will get a bereavement allowance of a fixed sum of 12,980 pounds. All right? 12,980 pounds. This is not negotiable. It's a fixed sum. And of course, the reasonable funeral expenses that you have taken. So these are the general damages to be calculated for non-fatal and fatal claims. Okay? So remember, the court achievement is to try their best to put the claimant into a position that he would have been if the tort was not committed. All right? Thank you very much. If you like this video, click like, subscribe, and share. But basically, just follow me, if you can, on Instagram, The Low Cat. Thank you.